Boy, did y'all see Martell's face when Melody said he got had to go sleep in them bunk beds? Boy, you really thought you was gonna get the cutty tonight. Melody said, no. You guys, what's up? Welcome back to your girl Gigi's channel. I appreciate you for tuning in. Y'all know what we're gonna be talking about today. We're gonna be talking about Love and Marriage Huntsville. They are on their way to not Alabama, is it somewhere in the cabin woods, okay? They're gonna be doing a little couples trip, and it started out a little rocky, but it's looking like there might be some ease, you know, going on later in the trip. But we're gonna get into all that. First, do your girl a favor, hit that subscribe button down there. I also want to say I appreciate a lot of you guys who recently subscribed. It was kind of a big bulk, so I usually do shout outs, but I can't do it this time because there were just so many. But I just want to say I love you guys. I appreciate all the, you know, the comments and everything. I drop down in there, try to show some love back to a couple of you guys. You know, I just want to let you know we see each other, okay? There's love both ways. And I just appreciate you guys for supporting your girl. You know, well, I'm kind of like new to this whole YouTube thing and the review channels. But, you know, it's your girl. I am who I am. And I just hope you guys, you know, follow for the ride. But nonetheless, you guys, let's get started. We're going to be talking about Love and Marriage Huntsville. It opens up with everybody on the way to the little cabins. Those cabins were nice, you guys. The only thing that freaked me out, gave me anxiety, was the fact that them holes was built off the side of a hill. Like, any moment a mudslide could happen, and we all got this bitch. But they were very beautiful, you know, to say the least. But like I said, everybody's on the way there, and their cars all having the same conversation, basically. How they expect the trip to go, what they expect everybody to say. Martell and Melody, like, Melody's sick, so she's like, Kimmi gave me pneumonia. Martell's like, you know, I'm ready for the trip. You know, I just hope nobody goes in saying a lot of stuff because, you know, I'll say something if I have to. But he's basically saying, let's talk it out and knock it out and, you know, everybody get their stuff on the table so the rest of the trip can go smoothly. Now, Maurice and Kimmi, we all know they're the middle. They're stuck and they're trying to mediate everything. And they're just hoping, like, this is going to be the one time everybody can just, like, be cool. Now, Tish and Marsaue. Tish is still stuck on this. I don't know why Melody, the hopes are so mad. Like, Tish, you gotta have some type of idea. Like, there's no way people just be showing this much spice or so much heat towards you and you have no idea why she might be feeling a type of way. But Marsaue basically said, I don't know, I don't care. Like, if this is gonna be the end of the relationship, it is what it is. And honestly, Marsaue, you trying to end this shit real quick because, you know, at the end of the day, Martell got your ass in a between a rock and a hard space. He really do. He's like, I just don't hope Maurice and Kimmi gonna be playing mediator all trip because I ain't in the mood for it. So Maurice and Kimmi get there first, and then Martell and Melody pull up right behind them. Melody come in with this freaking mask talking about, oh, you know, Kimmi, you got me sick. And Kimmi was like, bitch, no, I didn't. I had fungal bacteria. She's like, well, I mean, I got something. She said, well, you sure you didn't get it from them Bebe's kids? Them Bebe's kids. Y'all, that's a good show. Bebe's kids, I wish they would really bring that back. But you know, everybody basically greeting is cool, and they start doing rock, paper, scissors for the bedroom. And when they start going, Maurice took off before they could finish the game. He's talking about rock, paper, and he took off to the bedroom. Now, Martell tried to be slick in his confession, talking about, oh, you know, just like them cheaters, wouldn't you know, nigga, wouldn't you know. So Maurice and Kimmi claim their bedroom, and then Melody goes over there. She gets the second master bedroom. Now Martell walked in there thinking, oh, this is nice. She said, oh yeah, you know, I got this one. You know, you can sleep over there in the bunk beds. And he's like, y'all, he was so thrown off. He thought he really was getting ready to slide in this weekend. She said, do we sleep together at home? He was like, no. She's like, okay then, see ya. I'll see you later, Mr. Hole. So he walk over there like a little sad little puppy dog. And he's a little upset too because he's like, you know, I thought she was going to be a little more lenient. And also too, I just don't like the fact that she sometimes has this trait of not being able to leave things at home. So now the other couples are going to be seeing, you know, how we are in our relationship right now. And Maurice and Kimmi, speaking of that, see him walking across the bedroom. And they're like, nah, she not doing that. Like, this is a couple's trip. Is she really going to be like that? Yeah. Melly said, am I ever lenient? He like, nah, so bitch, nigga, you fucked up. So you gonna have to, you made your bed. Now you gonna have to sleep in it. Or in this case, you gonna have to step up there. You got bunk beds, okay? So Tish and Maurice, Marcel finally pull up, and they come in with gift bags, some good energy, and everybody's, you know, greeting them and stuff. And Tish is like, I got goodies, you know, since we're here without the kids. And they see it's basically sex toys. And the man is like, oh, yeah, we about to get this shit on and popping. Like, this is going to be good. And she gets to Melody, hands her a thing. And Melody's like, oh, you know, I didn't even, you know, use what we gave, what I got last time. Tish is like, girl, like, we here with no kids. Like, girl, we better do something. Well, Sadarpa's like, well, ain't nothing happening. Her and Martell ain't sleeping together. So everybody's like, and Mel basically let her know, like, we got a situation at home, and just because we here don't mean it's going to change. And you can tell Martell gets just so uncomfortable when it comes to talking about their shit. But, bruh, like, you did that to yourself, so you just going to have to lie in it, okay? So everybody's done. They done made up their beds and everything, or, made, you know, got to the rooms and stuff. So everybody's, the girls are cooking while the men are kind of, like, I guess, getting ready to grill the food. And it's a little awkward at first. There's nobody talking, but they did bring up a very deep subject about a boy committing suicide because he was gay and they were bullying him because he was kind of in a poor district. And, you know, Kimmi kind of reminds them, like, this is why we want to do the comeback group, just to build, you know, decent homes for people so we can bridge that gap between basically, like, lower income and high income homes. So it was very good to see that they gave that some acknowledgement. But then they start talking about something else, and out of nowhere, Sadara comes upstairs talking about tweet, tweet, tweet. Men gather around. We about to handle this beef gladiator style. He come up with these big ass Q-tips. And, you know, the men are like, oh, Maurice and Marceau, rather, like, were kind of into it. And Martell with his pissy ass attitude, like, this annoyed the fuck out of me. Like, you just couldn't cooperate for a little bit. He told me, oh, no, I'm not doing this bullshit. I'm not doing this. You know, we got issues. We gonna talk it out. Whoop-de-woo. Like, you could have said that in a different tone. Like, if you say, you know what, like, you know, we can't play these games, you know, because I feel like I might take it a little bit far. Like, he should just pull Marcel outside and have this conversation. But Sadark starts playing with him, hitting, you know, him in the head. Like, bro, it ain't that serious. Whoop-de-woo. And Martell pushes this nigga across the room, like, football style. And Maurice, and everybody else was looking like, like, Martell, what's going on? So Sadark kind of was thrown off, but he pushed them back. So now you can tell he's like, they're getting into it a little bit too serious. And finally they break it up. And Sadar's like, bro, like, come on now, quit playing. He's tapping across the head like, it's just fun. So Martell has just got this attitude. And Melody, he ends up going outside to, like, start the grill or whatever. And Melody goes to check on him. And she's like, okay, what's going on? Like, why did you get so intense so fast? He's like, you know, I'm just not in the mood to play. Like, this is my life. And she's like, uh-huh. And he's like, if he really wanted us to figure out something, we could have went hiking. Like, look where we're at. And he's like, you know, I'm really angry right now. You know, ain't no telling what I would have did. I would have hurt somebody. She's like, okay, Mayweather. And he's like, you know, it is what it is. I got it in me. So basically, honestly, y'all saw he was ready to go off on somebody. He's just got a lot of, you know, shit he's holding down because Melody's icing him out. But nigga, you did that to yourself. Don't be trying to take your anger out on everybody else for the shit you fucked up with. So the rest of the guys come outside, and Sadark was like, bro, what's going on? Like, is there anything you need to tell me? And of course, Martell want to play like everything's good in the hood. Talking about, oh, you know, we good. He's like, everything's fine with me. He's like, bro, like, it kind of got serious there. You know, we always, you know, play joke, play fighting. And Maurice and Marcel was like, bro, like, we saw y'all lock up. Like, it's something going on. And Martell was like, you know, we always play, but, you know, both people got to be in agreement. And Marcel kind of defended him, was like, you know, he's been a little, you know, intense lately, a little aggressive, but we got to understand where he's coming from. And Sadar's like, okay, that's fair. They handshake, cool, they done. So everybody's eating, and Sadark was like, look, you know, we all know what we're here for. Let's try and knock this out right now. And Tish kind of starts with, okay, you know, me and Marcel, we're just in the spot in our life where we just don't want negativity, and we're just looking to be around good, positive energy. And Martell cuts her the hell off. He talking about, oh, that's bullshit. Like, that's BS. Like, we're not going to do this fakery. Let's not throw this under the rug. He's like, we all know, you know, what my issue is. You know, I've talked to Marcel, had my issue with how I felt he was kicking me while he was down and constantly joking. You know, this is my life. We went through infidelity. I would expect him to, you know, lift me up and stuff. And Marcel kind of rebuttals with the look like, we only joked about the whole phone situation. Now, if y'all remember the phone situation, it started with you, Martell, Like, they at the football field. He's like, oh, let me go get my other phone. So Maurice and Marcel was like, other phone? Do Melody know about this phone? And they were kind of laughing, like, bro, you might be a little fucked up right now. And so Martell was like, you just kept digging and digging. He was like, bro, like, I joke with you to your face. Like, I never said nothing behind your back. And honestly, I wouldn't have said nothing if you guys weren't, quite frankly, comfortable with it. And the truth is, you guys have brought it up. You have talked about it openly. So this gives other people license to at least have some type of commentary or opinion about it. And you want to be mad at the world, Martell, but at the end of the day, you embarrass your woman. You make this shit public because you couldn't keep your side chick in control, because this bitch is comfortable enough to call Melody and ask for your ass on the phone. So, like, bruh, like I said, you made your bed, now you gotta lie in it. So Dark is like trying to like mediate and was like, you know, Marcel, you know, if you were in his situation, would you want people joking? And he kind of admits like, no, I wouldn't like that. But, you know, I gotta remember, you know, sometimes because we are so close and joke around, maybe I went past, you know, the comfort, the line or whatever. So Dark's like, man, y'all know Martell's sensitive. Like, granted, we all joke together. We just gotta remember his emotions, whoop-de-woo. So Marcel apologizes. And then Siddharth was like, Martell, you got anything to say or apologize for? Martell apologizes for cussing and being angry, but that's all he apologized for. And his confessional, he very well made the point that I only apologize for that because the cheating stuff is true. Now, Tish picked up on the apology that Martell gave and not the fact that he didn't apologize for the whole 20 girlfriends accusation. And Tish, your man ain't saying no, or you need to say no, apologize to my wife, all that type of shit, because it happened, girl. And I think at this point, your freaking intuition is ringing so hard, but you were trying to blame Melody for bringing it up and saying it so many times. But Marcel ain't defending himself because he can't defend himself against it. Him and Martell clearly were out there in the streets doing their dirt together. It's just that Martell's came back to bite him in the ass first. Bitch, your season is next season. We gonna see her, bitch. Marcel's little side tramp in a second. So then, Siddharth's like, okay, y'all are cool. Like, but, you know, we can't go without the wives being cool. So Tish tells Kimmi, like, you know, Tish tells Mel, like, you know, I just don't want to deal with this. At this point, I don't care. I'm not trying to be rude. It's just like, this just isn't that important to me. Like, you know, we just need to be positive. Melody said, I feel like you question my character, put my character in question. And then Melody starts going real slick, poking at the bear, talking about, well, you know, as y'all know, this infidelity happened, but I just have to say, you know, things weren't happening in my marriage until I got around, you know, certain couples and a group of friends. So Kimmi was like, I need you to explain what you mean by that. She was like, all I'm saying is, you know, Martell might have seen the way you guys make y'all's plates for y'all husband and cook for them. And, you know, I was never doing it for him before, but now all of a sudden he's expecting that of me. And because I'm not all this domestic, you know, he wants to go out and do what he do. And it's like, bitch, how you blaming everybody else for what Martell did? He is a grown-ass man. He know whether to cheat, not to cheat on his wife or not. Like, what? Like, bro, you can't blame it on other people. It's a dark set that, like, hold up, wait, there's a difference between, oh, you not cooking as much as Kimmi and you hanging out with these other men, and because they're cheating, your ass is out there being unfaithful too. Like, two totally different things. And Tish was like, no, maybe your man needs to be a stronger man and not be easily influenced. Now, I agree with her on that part. Well, Marcel kind of says this little comment, like, look, Melody, we understand what y'all went through, and, you know, sometimes, you know, you might think people weren't there for you, but a lot of people were rooting for you behind the scenes. But at the end of the day, we're just men, you know, figuring it out through. And Melody is, y'all, them sly, slick comments, as Tish like to say she do, that she know she do. She talking about, you know what? That's a good one, Marcel. Cheers to that. Cheers to men figuring it out. And she's looking at Melody, and you can just tell Tish is picking up on the energy she's putting down. So finally they go upstairs and Marcel is checking on Tish and she's like, you know, I'm just so annoyed. Melody's like saying specific things and I'm trying to figure out why she's saying, you know, Tish and Kimmi did this, so that's why Martell did this. And Marcel has a way of saying everything and nothing at the same time. He's like, we just got to think about where she's at in her head. She's not thinking sober thoughts. You know, she's thinking from a place of hurt and pain. You know, I just like I had to feel like, you know, put myself in Martell's shoes. I went with myself, you know, people joking about our situation if we were going through that. And Tish is like, you know, I don't like how he's like, you know, blown over it and he didn't defend himself and asking for my Martell to apologize. And Millie keeps saying the same thing. And I trust my husband, but he's not making me feel better because he's not reassuring me. Bitch, he can't reassure you. Like, girl, like, you not this dumb, Tish. Like, Millie might say, bitch, you is in denial. And I really think Tish is doing everything not to believe it because she just doesn't want to be in that position that Melody is in. She done did all this shit talking about Martell and her, and now you thought you was all high and mighty with your good relationship. Now look at you. Y'all gonna be in the same goddamn boat, bitch. Y'all about to be paddling together, you and Melody, with these fuck niggas that y'all got. So Marcel kind of manipulates it and kind of gets Tish to calm down. It's like, you know, we just, you know, we're gonna worry about us. You know, we're not gonna worry about how this got into our relationship. We're just gonna do us and, you know, be on vacation. Yeah, okay, we'll see how that goes. So, y'all, we get to the end of the episode where Maurice is telling Kimmi about his conversation with Kiawah. And Maurice, bruh, I've been riding for you all goddamn season, but you done made your first mistake. Like, bruh, he tells Kimmi he invited Kiawah to Huntsville. And he didn't say this on camera, obviously. But all I saw was him saying he would pay for the flights for them to come. Now he's telling Kimmi, I'm going to put them up rent-free, mortgage-free in a house that I paid off. What? Huh? You doing what, Maurice? Who ain't paying rent? Nigga, I know you love your son, but damn. So now Kimmy's like, wait, this woman has disrespected me and I have never said nothing negative about her. And now she feels comfortable enough to talk to my husband. And then at that, Maurice, you didn't give Kimmi a heads up and you didn't talk to her first about it. Like, bruh, that's not what good husbands do. So now Kimmy's feeling the type of way, but now he's like, why are you so upset? Like, why'd you have to brace yourself for the conversation, bitch? Yes, because anybody can see Kiowa's attitude is funky through the screen. It just emotes, like, just pettiness. And then he's like, you know, what am I supposed to do? I want my son. And Kimmy's not trying to stand in the way of your son, but do it reasonably. Like, the ex-wife is really being petty because how is it that Maurice can go 12, 13 years without seeing his son? Sacrifice that, but you can't do that in return for him, especially the fact that y'all already had this agreement. Like, bruh. And then you got a husband who's okay moving to Huntsville. So clearly he's a bum. And the fact that he's comfortable accepting another man's basically charity. Like, bruh, you got with somebody, you got with the it'll do nigga. That's what you did. You married an it'll do fool because you saw him move on and you felt like you had to move on too. And you need to compete with him. But at the end of the day, he had a glow up and you fucked up that relationship, Kiawah. And she's holding that son over Maurice's head so bad. So now Kimmy's like, well, how long did it take for her to accept the offer? And he was trying to say like, oh, you know, it wasn't like that. She was like, seconds. I wasn't even there and I knew seconds. And which makes me believe that she's still into you. And after that, he's like, you know, we just need to be in a better place. You guys don't know each other. That's it. It ain't about they don't know each other. It's the fact that Kiawah really disrespects. She doesn't respect Kimmi at all. She dismisses Maurice and starts crying. And I felt so goddamn bad. And that's where the episode ends, you guys. It was a lot. So the cabin trip is kind of okay. But next week, though, oh, shit. But your girl's going to be here to tell you about it. So y'all drop down in the comment. Tell me how this episode went, what y'all thought about it. You know, just like your girl's video and subscribe to my channel. And I will catch you guys on the flip side. Deuces.